This conference will
Good
now be
morning,
recorded.
Papu, Daniel. Okay, here's the agenda for today's session.
Hey, Raman. Good morning.
Hey, good morning. Good morning.
Hey, Babu. Hey, Murli.
Yeah. Here is the agenda for today's session. We are going to, so far what we did, we discussed about some basics of Hadoop, and in terms of architectural perspective, we have discussed about these Hadoop daemons, and we discussed about how to perform a read and write activity, so by using Hadoop block related concept. What is blocks? And what is the default size of the blocks? And here, whether we completed a read and write. Here today, what we are going to do, we are going to discuss about this as with a small example, the HDFS and the MapReduce program. What is MapReduce? What are all the things that it is involved with respect to a real time example, a Rayman example? And followed with, we are going to discuss about this Hadoop cluster, characteristics of Hadoop cluster, and what are the different types of Hadoop cluster. Okay, if on time permits, I will let you know the installation perspective. So before installation, we need to know about the functionalities of secondary name node. Okay, these are all the things that is planned for today's session. And with respect to Hadoop has been concerned, Hadoop has been divided into the following two core components. One is HDFS, stands for Hadoop Distributed. Hadoop Distributed File System, and second one is MapReduce, the programming model of Hadoop. Okay. So what is HDFS? HDFS stands for Hadoop Distributed File System. What is file system? Here, for each and every operating system, we have different storage structure. For example, in case of Windows, we divide this hard disk into C drive, D drive, E drive, and we store, we create directories or subdirectories under which we can store files. Okay, so in case of Linux, we have a root. Under root, we will be creating slices, partitions. Okay, under etc, under device, under home, like we will be organizing files. So this is governed by a file system. So Windows file systems are, we have FAT, FAT32, FAT16, NTFS network file sharing. There are some of the file systems of Windows, ext2, ext3, ext4, NFSnet file, network file sharing. These are all some sample file systems of Linux. Similarly, here Hadoop is a distributed data storage and data processing. Here, the data splitting and data storage will be governed by a file system called as HDFS, Hadoop Distributed File System. Here, the Hadoop Distributed File System is nothing but, so what are all the nodes that we configure as a data node? All these hard disks of the associated nodes, okay, togetherly formatted to form a Hadoop file system. So if you have 5 data nodes, each data node is assumed to be having 2 TB instance. There are 10 TB. This 10 TB, even though it is of a separate hard disk of each 2 TB size, so once it is formatted, it behaves as if as a single hard disk with 10 TB. Okay, this is the here. This file system that we need to create at the time of installation of Hadoop, you need to create this Hadoop file system. Okay, so here the file system will take care of all the governance associated with the data storage in the data nodes. Okay, so here this Hadoop file system consists of the following thing: data node n, and on top of the data node we have task tracker, which is responsible for execution of the task. Then what is MapReduce? You have data in this, you have your Hadoop file system, you have data in this Hadoop file system. if you want to do a process on top of it, the programming model that we need to use is MapReduce programming model. Okay, yesterday itself we had a glance of MapReduce. Here you want to write a map function, and here the input need to be given to the map function. Then the map function is subjected to several transformations like a shuffling, sorting, combiner, partitioner. This is a, okay, and the output has been fed as an input to the reduce function, and the reduce function will give you the final output. I will let you know with a small example of what logic that you need to incorporate for map and reduce and how it is going on. Okay, so here you can make use of programming languages like Java, Python, Perl, etc. Okay, so for writing this MapReduce. Here in Hadoop version 1, we have MapReduce version 1. Okay, so in Hadoop version 2, we have advanced MapReduce, okay, which is implemented by using another framework called YARN, yet another resource navigation. So now we have a replacement for MapReduce in form of Apache Spark. Apache Spark also in-memory data processing, that is distributed data storage and data processing framework, but here it is much more superior than that of this Hadoop MapReduce. Okay, that too we have a Spark. We are using Spark as its programming language, Python as programming language, Scala as programming language. Okay, so Spark is cluster. We use Python, Scala, everything. So we will be dealing with this advanced MapReduce program using Spark by using the language of Python in our course. Okay, so these are all some of the things that is associated with MapReduce. Yesterday we had discussed. So here, these are all the functions that you need to write in Java or Python, whatever it may be. So for example, for a particular business logic, if it needs 100 lines of coding, the same thing can be achieved using a Hadoop ecosystem components. We have two components, one by name Hive, another one by name Pig. Hive was initially developed by Facebook. Pig was initially developed by Yahoo. And laterally, they gave it to the open source community. Hive uses a language called Hive Query language. Pig uses a language called Pig Latin. So these are very simple languages. It is more or less similar to normal SQL. It is more or less similar to normal shell scripting. Okay. Here internally, the code will be transformed into MapReduce, and here it will do the process on top of it. Here we are going to discuss about, with a small example, what is MapReduce, how the data has been split, what is the advantage of going for increasing the number of data nodes in performing in with respect to getting a better performance. Okay, this is the overview. Let me take a small scenario. So let me take, we have a Reliance store. Okay, a Reliance store, Reliance apparels. So let me assume that Reliance is having around 100 stores throughout India. Let me have a store at Chennai. Let me have a store, assume that we have a store at Madurai. Let me have a store at Coimbatore. Let me have a store at Bangalore. Similarly, there are around, it is assumed that 100 stores of Reliance apparel. Okay, Reliance announces a new sale. Okay, Reliance announces, let me take a RD sale for 2 months of sales. Here the 2 months of sales, here 50% offer. Therefore, people start flooring Reliance. Here, total duration of sale is 2 months. So at the average, per store, each day average sale is, it is assumed to be 5,000 per day. So in Madurai, it may be 3,000. In Chennai, it may be 10,000. In Bangalore, it may be 15,000. In Coimbatore, it may be 3,500. Like, let me take for our simplicity, but per day, okay, per store, it is 5,000 transactions per day. Totally, the sale is for 2 months. Therefore, into 60 days, which is equivalent to 3 lakhs of transactions per store. And total store is into 100. So there are 3 crores of transactions. The transaction contains the following information. It contains the sequence number, the customer number, the customer name, item number, item name, cost of item, number of items purchased, total cost of purchase. These are all the transaction records. Mode, payment mode, cash payment or what set of payment, billing address or delivery address. Okay, these are all the information that is associated. Here, the CEO of Reliance. Okay, so out of these 3 crores of transactions that has been happened across 100 stores, he is interested in finding out the following items. He wants the statistics of 3 apparels, Louis Philippe, Van Heusen and Peter England apparels. So what is the total sales of Louis Philippe across all the stores, and which store resulted in a minimum sale, which store resulted in a maximum sale? Also, because if we know the store behind this minimum and maximum sales, in if we can able to identify the root cause for the minimum sale or root cause for the maximum sale, we can able to do better management with respect to the next sales. So you want these statistics. Here, how you do this? So if it is a traditional RTBMS, this 3 crores of transaction records need to be placed on a centralized database server. You have a database server. Here you need to place these 3 crores of transaction records. Okay. And then you want to write a business logic to look for the items like Louis Philippe, for example, item name Louis Philippe, Louis Philippe shirt, Louis Philippe pant. Okay. And similarly, Van Heusen shirt, Van Heusen pant. So like we have item ID, item name, etc., etc. Okay, so here out of these 3 core transactions, which involves several items, out of which the CEO is interested only the sales details of the following 3 items. There may be some other apparels, there may be some other items, okay, apart from these above said brands. So here, the business logic, what it needs to do, it wants to first filter only the transactions involving the above said LP, VH and Peter England out of these 3 crores, and it wants to do a computation on top of it. Okay, assume that it take one microsecond for performing a transaction activity, a business logic filtration on a single record. If the 3 crores of transaction records has been stored on a single server, it is assumed that we need 3 crore microseconds, okay, to perform this. Here, instead of going up with this traditional RTBMS, if the data has been stored in your Hadoop, okay, let me assume initially we have a 10 node cluster, data node 1 up to data node, 10 node cluster. Here, all the data which is happening on day to day. So, here in Chennai store, and data will be stored in RDBMS. It may be Oracle, MySQL, anything. So day-to-day transaction has been stored in a database. At the end of the day, the transaction has been fetched and it will be stored in the HDFS file system. Okay, this is your Hadoop cluster. Who takes the responsibility of fetching this? Here we can configure a tool called as Scoop. SQL to Hadoop. Scoop stands for SQL to Hadoop and vice versa. We can configure a scoop to crawl data from the RDBMS data source. These are all transaction data, day-to-day transaction. At the end of the day, the data will be brought into this HDFS. How it will be stored? Assume that this 3 crores of records has been stored across these 10 data nodes, equally split 30 lakhs records each, 30 lakhs records each. Okay. Here, out of these 30 lakhs data node, okay, up to data node, that we have 30 lakhs of records. Here, you want to write the business logic. here what logic that you need to write in the map function. In the map function, you want to write a logic here. Out of this the transactions, you want to find out the transaction item name or item number. Okay, Louis Philippe, Van Hoosen or Peter Lindbergh. So out of 3 crores, you want to filter only those transactions. This is the logic that you want to write in the map function. Once you want to subject it to the above set transformation, shuffling, sorting, combiner and partitioning, and at the end the reduce function will perform aggregate operation. Okay, what operation? Here we have a Louis Philippe reducer, we have a Van Hoosen, we have a Peter Lindbergh, 3 reduce functions. Okay, here for example, the business logic of map function, assume that it is a somewhat 20 lines of coding. That's all, maximum 10 to 15, 20 lines of coding. The 20 lines of coding will be copied across all the data nodes where the transaction data has been stored. Okay, so here we have data assumed to be stored on 10 data nodes. Here the business logic will be copied to all the data nodes and it will apply on the 30 lakhs of records which is stored on each data node. Out of 30 lakhs of records, it will filter out how many Louis Philippe, how many Van Hoosen and how many Peter Lindbergh. Similarly, for all the data nodes, we will be getting the total number of Louis Philippe, Van Hoosen and Peter Lindbergh. Let me take this out. Okay, so after that what we can do? So this is the logic that you need to put here. Here you can able to do concurrently finding out the following items. Since we have data splitted across 10 data nodes and your business logic also being copied and it will be performing its action on all the data stored on the 10 data nodes parallel. Assume that this transaction takes 1 millisecond. Therefore, being it is done concurrently, I can able to achieve using 30 lakhs millisecond if I have a 10 data node. Assume if I have a 100 data node, here instead of 3 lakhs, so 30 lakhs, we have the transaction 3 lakhs of transaction which is split across this 100 data nodes. Therefore, I need only 3 lakhs of milliseconds to compute this computation. So these are all layman statistics to make you understand how this approach works. So here, based upon this number of data nodes, the time taken for the transaction, the time taken for the execution of business logic has been reduced to a great extent here. Okay, so the reduce function, what it will do, it will take the output of each. It will take the output of each data node. Assume that you have the following data nodes. You have data node. Data node 1 will have Louis Philippe, Van Hoosen, Peter Lindbergh. Similarly, all the data nodes will have the value. Okay. Louis Philippe, Van Hoosen, Peter Lindbergh. Okay. It is assumed you have 10 data nodes. After the apply of the map function, we have the values, Louis Philippe, for example, 1000 out of these 30 lakhs of transactions in data node 1, we have 1000 transactions involving Louis Philippe, 1500 transactions involving Van Hoosen, 2000 transactions involving Peter Lindbergh. Similarly, 2000 Louis Philippe from data node 2, it is assumed out of 30 lakhs of transactions, so 3000 Van Hoosen and 3000 Peter Lindbergh. And here 1000 Louis Philippe, 1000 Van Hoosen, 1000 Peter Lindbergh. Let me assume. So this is the output at the end of your map function execution. Now the reducer, we have, as I told, we have 3 reducers configured. We have a reducer for Louis Philippe. We have a reducer for Van Hoosen. We have a reducer for Peter Lindbergh. What this reduce function do? It will take all the partial outputs it got from the map across all the 10 data nodes. It takes this output and it will aggregate this output. For example, totally there are 4000 Louis Philippe. Similarly, the Van Hoosen, what it will do? Van Hoosen will take the van was and letter output. Okay, here 1500, 3000 and 1000. It will take all these things and it will do a computation. Okay, totally for 5500 van was and, right? This is the logic that you need to write on the reduce function. Okay, so the map and reduce logic need to be written by the developer, and all the remaining it will happen internally, the shuffling, sorting, combiner and partitioner. So this is the way by which here MapReduce programmer want to, based upon this atomic business logic, you want to write a logic using map and reduce. Here the same sort of thing you will be using in case of our Apache Spark, we'll be using a tool called as PySpark to write the opposite things. We write a filter function, we will write a map function, we will write a reduce function. Any logic can be completed at maximum within these three activities. Okay, so if you take some examples, you have understanding. Now is it clear? So here this scope will do this. Here you can write this logic either using Java, or what you can do, you can use this Hive or Pig, as I already told, to write the business logic, and the Hive query language, Pig Latin, those syntax will be converted into a MapReduce internally. So it is highly transparent to the developer and do the process on top of it. This is the way by which a MapReduce programming will be executed. Okay, so this is a example of a small MapReduce. I will take you some other example.
Raman, try to interrupt.
Yes.
Could you repeat the difference between map function and reduce function?
Hey, the voice is echoing, Babu.
Yes. I'm also facing a challenge. Probably so.
So now we discuss the map and reduce function, is it? You want to repeat again?
Yes, just repeat the map function and reduce function difference.
That's what we have so far discussed. You put in here it. Map function, so here it is assumed you have 10 data nodes. So here the 3 crores of transaction records has been splitted evenly across these data nodes. It is assumed that we have 30 lakhs of records. What we need is, we want to identify the transaction involving Louis Philippe, Van Nuysen and Peter Lingler. Here your map logic, your map function will segregate, okay, will apply a filter on top of it, the 3 lakhs records, to identify the Louis Philippe, Van Nuysen and Peter Lingler. This is the map output. This is the map function output. For data node 1, out of the 30 lakhs records, you have 1000 Louis Philippe, 1500 Van Nuysen, 2000 Peter Lingler. Similarly, for each and every data node, the business logic here, the data will be ideal. The business logic will move to the server where you have data. In your traditional environment, what happened? So you have a server, your business logic will be ideal. The data will be moved into the server. The business logic will apply on top of the data in your traditional programming. Here in MapReduce programming, it is vice versa. Okay, so being the amount of data that we are going to process is in a huge volume size, moving the data into the server where your application running will be a time consuming. Therefore, the business logic, which may run into 20-40 lines of coding, okay, if you write using a Hive or Pig, at the maximum we can able to complete any logic with the maximum of 50 lines of coding, 50 to 100 lines of coding. Okay, so that logic will be copied across all the data nodes where we have data, and the logic will operate on top of the partial records, set of records which is stored on the data node. In this example, each data node is assumed to be having 30 lakhs of records. Here the map logic will be applied on 30 lakhs to identify the LP, Van Nuysen and Peter Lingler associated with each data node. This is the map function. Is it clear?
I got it. the reduce function. This
yeah.
is clear.
So whether you got, once the map function is applied, what happened is it is assumed that each will have the opposite value. There are 10,000 records involving Louis Philippe, 1,500 in the data node. Similarly, each data node will have a partial output. Is it? What I am looking for? I am looking for all the transactions out of the 3 crores. How many transactions involving Louis Philippe, Van Hoosen and Peter England? That's what I need to test. I want to get this partial output from each cent. Please, can you mute yourself? Babu. So here, I got the partial output. After that, I will make it in the new slide. So this is your data node. Assume that you have 10 such data nodes.
Raman, the summation of the last 3 data is called reduce function.
Yeah, aggregation. That's what I told. Aggregate. So LP, Van Hoosen, Peter England. This is the output of map. Okay, say 1,000, 1,000, 1,000. Let me take for our example. Similarly, each data node will have its own output. LP, Van Hoosen, Peter England. Here it is assumed 2,000, 3,000, 4,000. Similarly, for all the data node, we will get the output. Is it? Is that all the data node will get this output? It is assumed 2,000, 5,000, and 2,000. Therefore, we have the partial output of our requirement, which is splitted across all the data nodes. You need to sum all these things. Here, the reduce function will perform this activity. It will take, we have a reducer for Louis Philippe, we have a reducer for Van Hoosen, we have a reducer for Peter England. It will take all the Louis Philippe value which a map is outputted across all the data nodes, and it will perform an aggregate sum operation. Okay, here the value here is 6,000 Louis Philippe. Similarly, it will take all the Van Hoosen, okay, all the Van Hoosen output, and it will make a sum of all the outputs. Here in this case, it is 9,000. Similarly, here it took all the Peter England and it will make a sum. This is the logic that you want to write on the reduce. It is 7,000.
Okay,
is it clear? So
clear
according to this example, this is the logic. Each and every logic will differ according to our requirement.
Clear.
Yeah, yes.
So the number of map reducers will get created automatically depends on our conditional criteria. Is that?
Here, the number of map and reducer want to be specified by us. Here, actually, the number of map, we will discuss why you are coming into this map reduce discussion. Just I am giving you a bird's view. While we go to the MapReduce, I will give you more information on what is MapReduce. So if we take another example, let me take an example here, how to count the number of words. Now, if you take this, so here, this is a text file. Assume that I want to find out how many words are there. This is the business logic, a word count. Here, the input is split into a key and value pairs in this map reduce. Okay, each and every line will be taken, and this is your key and value pair. The line number is key, and these are all the values. Okay, so the line number 1 comma line, this is line number 1, line number 2 and line number 3. Line number 2 comma all the values associated, line number 3. Here it is splitted here. The input has been splitted. Okay, once after that what it will do? So it will form this, the map function, it will take the each and every key and it will replace, for example, deer one, bear one, river one, like it will substitute the values for each and everything. This is the map logic. Here, so the data being it is stored across multiple nodes. It is assumed that each and every map logic is stored on a separate data nodes. Then it is shuffled, okay, and it is sorted. So how many bears out of the three records we have here one bear and another here one bear value. Therefore, bear 1, 1, car 1, 1. This is shuffling, sorting, and combiner logic. So we have a value here. The reduce function make an aggregate. Okay, for example, here 1, 1 is 2, 1, 1 is 3. Like the reduce function is aggregate, and the final result will be got. So here the map shuffling, sorting, combiner, partitioner, everything happens in the following phase. It is not mandatory. You need to do shuffling, sorting, combiner, and partition all the four. Some may have only shuffling, some may need combiner and partitioner. It all depends upon the business logic. What we need is a map and reduce. This is another example here. Assume that if you have once again 1 lakh of record, so here this contains a data set with 1 lakh of line, or whether it is 1 crore of line, or it is 100 crores of line, so it will the business logic is same. Okay, based upon this number of here the mapping is logic the person. So the data has been splitted and it is stored across each and every data node. Here the number of map function, the number of reduce function, how it will look like, we will discuss during the map reduce discussion. This is an example. So to be a layman point of view, divide and conquer approach, that's all. By means of parallel processing, we divide the data set, splitter the data set, and do these parallel processing operations on top of the data set concurrently to get a better performance. This is the layman and definition for MapReduce. Okay, our old approach. Is it clear?
Clear, Aman.
Yeah. Okay, while writing a map reduce using, we will be discussing our map reduce using Python. At that time, you have a clear understanding. Thanks a lot. Okay, so these are all the ways by which you can make in real time your cluster will be like this only. Here, you have a rack. Okay, across these racks only, the clusters will be stored. Okay, you have data nodes. Okay. So job tracker, secondary name nodes separated in each and every rack. Also because if a name node and secondary name node lies on the same rack connected with the switch, if a power supply for the rack fails or a switch fails, you couldn't do any activity. So if it is on a separate rack, in this case, if a name node down, then after the recovery of the switch or after the recovery of the power supply, while it is hopping, the secondary name node will help the name node in letting it certain information that we are going to discuss. So you know already aware of the functions of name node. The functions of name node is used to maintain the metadata information. Now, what is the function of secondary name node? We are going to discuss about that. a second part of our today's agenda. So assume that you have a 5 node cluster. Data node 1, data node 2, data node 3, data node 4, and data node 5. Okay, it is assumed you have a file 1 whose size is 192 MB divided into 3 blocks, block B1, block B2, and block B3. Initially, these blocks have been distributed, block B1, B2, B3, B1, B2, B3. Here you have B3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. So this is the distribution. Let me take for our example. Here, this is your block B1 and you have block B2 and finally you have block B3. Three blocks, okay, have been distributed. Here, the block B1 has been stored in data node 1, data node 2 and data node 4. Similarly, block B2 has been stored in data node 1, data node 3, and data node 4. And block B3 has been stored in data node 2, data node 3, and data node 5. So these are all the metadata information. Okay. So here, where the name node maintains the metadata information? This is your name node. The name node maintains the metadata information under two files, as I already told. One is FS image, file system image. The second file name is edit log. Here, first when the name node starts, the FS image will be populated with this information. This is the information that is stored in the FS image. Okay. So here, let me assume the data node fails. Okay, let me assume the data node DN5 fails. Here now what happens to the block B3? The block B3, instead of maintaining 3 copies, now we have a 2 copy. It is called block under replication or under replicated block. Here, immediately the name node will take a action. Name node will look for the metadata. What are all the blocks that has been stored on the failed data node? In data node 5, we have block B3. What is the other location? We have this block. We have this block in data node 3 and data node 2. Therefore, what the name node will do? It will instruct any one of the node. Okay, example. Let me imagine that the name node send the instruction to data node 3. Data node 3, you please copy the block B3 into either data node 1 or data node 4. It is assumed that the block B3 has been copied into the data node 4. Now, there is a change in the cluster. That change here, the block B3, because of failure of this data node 5, initially we have it at data node 2 and data node 3. Now we have block instead of data node 5, because of its failure, it is stored under the data node 4. This modified information of the cluster will be stored in the edit log. This is the information that it is stored in edit log. Whenever there is a change in the cluster, one such change is this example. So those informations will be recorded in the edit log. Now you have a tool. In FS image, the block B3 is defined, stored in data node 5. Whereas in edit log, the block B3 is defined as stored in data node 4. Here we have a problem called data inconsistency problem. We have two different values for the same block information. Who will resolve that? Okay, you know, human brain can recognize that this read log is updated. This updation need to be applied on FS image also. Here comes the secondary name node. What the secondary name node will do here is, this is your name node. This is your secondary name node. For every default 1 hour once, every 1 hour once, it will take this FS image. This is your old FS image and this is your edit log. Secondary name node will take all the things and it will update the content of FS image with the content of edit log. Therefore, after updation, bug B3 now will hold the value data node 2, data node 3, and data node 4. This updated FS image, here this updated FS image will be back copied as a new FS image, okay, by replacing the old FS image, and edit log now will be free. So what are all the changes that will be recorded? Once again, after 1 hour, by default, 1 hour once means by default. You can even make it as 1 minute once. It is configurable. Okay, this is the way by which at any point of time, secondary name node will maintain an updated copy of FS image in its hard disk. Where the RAM node maintain FS image and edit log? In the RAM memory. Whereas the secondary name node, after performing this activity, it will get an updated copy of FS image. Then it will store the updated copy in its hard disk. Therefore, in case if a name node fetch, being those information has been stored in the RAM memory, RAM is a volatile memory, but all the content that it is present in the RAM, okay, will be erased, is it? So at that time of recovery of the name node, the RAM was found to be empty. The name node doesn't know what is the status, who are all present, how many files, where the files has been stored, what are all the access permissions. Everything will be done on the secondary name node will maintain a copy. So at that time, what it will do, it will take this updated copy and it will place in the RAM memory. So this is the activity done by the secondary name node. So the secondary name node will help the name node in letting the name node the status of the cluster at the time of failure. It is not a replacement. Please kindly make a note of it. So here, this is the way by which the secondary name node functions. If you have any doubt, if a name node downs, there is no other option, the cluster down.
Raman, what is this? We repeat, if name node down,
the cluster will down. You can't do any action on a cluster. Why? Name node alone will maintain all the metadata. If there is no metadata, then the name node doesn't know what to do.
Okay.
Here the metadata will be maintained as a backup copy by the secondary name node. So as per the server description. Therefore, the secondary name node helps the name node in taking the metadata information from the hard disk and place the metadata in the RAM memory of the name node. Once the metadata is placed in the RAM memory, name node reads the metadata and came to know the status of the cluster. Okay.
This conference will now be recorded.
So with respect to this number of data nodes has been concerned, we can categorize the cluster into small cluster, medium cluster, and enterprise cluster. A small cluster is one having number of data nodes in terms of 10s, 20s, 30s, etc. A medium cluster is one which has number of data nodes in terms of 100s, 200s, etc. Enterprise cluster is one which have data nodes in terms of 1000, 2000s. As of my knowledge, the world's largest cluster is Yahoo with 70,000 data nodes. Okay, with respect to our curriculum has been concerned, so we can configure a two cluster, either a single node cluster or a multi-node cluster, multi-node Hadoop cluster. Okay, so single node cluster means this is for learning purpose. Here you will be having a one computer. In the computer, you configure a secondary name node, secondary name node, job tracker, task tracker, okay, and data node. All the five will run on the same computer itself. In a multi-node, we can have a separate computer called a name node, a secondary name node, a job tracker, and according to your requirement you can have multiple data nodes. Okay, so this is a multi-node cluster. So this is your production setup. Real time you will be using with a multi-node cluster. Here you can set up a multi-node cluster either by using a physical servers or by using a virtualization softwares like VMware, VirtualBox, Hyper-V, okay, or you can set up using any public cloud or private cloud, either in a public cloud like AWS, Azure, or in a private cloud. So our curriculum deals with how to set up a multi-node cluster using our cloud. Okay, also here if you want you can also do this using a VMware. Both the thing that we will do for our purpose, what are all the things that we plan for, we can do. We install all these, we install Hive, we install Pig, we install Scoop, we can install Flume. All the actions can be done on a single node itself. So here what you want to install on a single node, same need to be repeated on a multi-node. 99% it is the same. 1% you want to do certain additional configurations, that's all. Okay, you can able to learn all the thing on a single node cluster. So you can create a VM with the 4 microprocessor minimum recommender and 4 GB of RAM for our Hadoop discussion. And for our Spark discussion laterally for MapReduce, I need a machine with 8 microprocessor and a minimum of 8 GB of RAM. Okay, this is a minimum recommendation. If not 8, you need to have minimum of 4 microprocessor and 8 GB of RAM is mandatory. Why? So because we are dealing with a large data sets. Under this, you can take a, instead of a VM, you can take instance from cloud. Okay, for your learning purpose. These are all the setup that we are planning for. Yes, here if it is a single node, everything has been configured. If it is a multi-node, each and everything can be configured separately. Or what we can do, if it is a small cluster, okay, here you can have one server and you can have a name node, a secondary name node on this server, and you have a job tracker on the separate server. For a small cluster or medium cluster, you can combine name node, secondary name node on one thing and job tracker on another thing. For enterprise cluster alone, you need to configure each and everything and separately. In our multi-node, what we will be doing here, you will create a 3 nodes. I will let you know creation of 3 nodes, data node 1, data node 2, and you have a name node, secondary name node and job tracker, all the 3 configured on our server. And the data nodes, if you want, you can make it as 3 data nodes. All the data nodes are be configured. So what I am going to do, my laptop is a i7 with 16 GB of RAM. So I can install a virtualization software. I am going to use VMware workstation, using which I can create these 4 virtual machines, virtual machine 1, virtual machine 2. Okay, so here this i7 consists 8 microprocessor core and I have 16 GB. Here what I am going to do, so for my physical server I will be using 2 microprocessor and 2 GB of RAM. The remaining for all the 4 I am going to assign. For my name nodes, 2 microprocessor and 4 GB of RAM. For all my data nodes, 1 microprocessor and 2 GB of RAM. So totally 3 microprocessor, here 5 microprocessor plus 2, 7 microprocessor. I can make use of 7 microprocessor. Here 4 GB, 2, 6, 10 GB. Here I can make use of 10 GB. Since my laptop is having enough resources, I can set up this multi-node. So you want to set up the multi-node based upon your hardware configuration of your system. Is it clear? Can you make a note of this setup? Please make a note of this setup.